Good evening,
Yes,
ladies
sir.
and gentlemen. Welcome to the international webinar on methodological application for cybersecurity using deep learning techniques organized by IRH Webinars in association with ITI Group. On behalf of the entire organizing community, I'm Isaac Behra, organizing secretary, would like to welcome you all for this webinar. Ladies and gentlemen, let me introduce our organization. The motto behind this nonprofit association is to bridge the gap between students, professors, academics, and industrialists from multidisciplines. Apart from organizing various seminars, expert talks, and conferences, we have various highly rated multidisciplinary journals in the field of science, engineering, technology, and management. Since our inception, we have been arranged various London, Australia, Bangkok, Kuala Lumpur, India, etc. More than 1 lakh people across the globe are associates with us. More than 5 lakh research papers have been presented and published during our journey. Today, I'm glad to welcome you all as a member of this fastest growing network for the advancement of science and technology in terms of research and innovation. Today, we were very much fortunate to have an eminent professor and expert who is joining this webinar as expert speaker and guest. Her name is Gitanjali Rave. Presently, she is working as a senior teaching fellow, Department of Master of Computer Application, MSRIT, Bangalore. Now, I would like to welcome up Professor Gitanjali Rave to deliver the webinar.
Thank you, sir. Thanks for the warm welcome. Webinar topic is a current topic. Today we see that, you know, we are all working from home or we are all having our lectures delivered through net. Now, the more the usage of net, the more we need to try to diffuse or compact the cyber criminals trying to steal data. How can that be possible with the current trend of artificial intelligence or deep learning techniques or through machine learning techniques? There are a lot of methodological applications that we can do to prevent or to safeguard the cyber works that we try to do. This is my research area.
Yes, ma'am, I can see now.
Yeah. So this has always been my area of research. As I always talk about cybersecurity, either it would be with deep learning technique or machine learning technique or artificial intelligence or data mining. Now, with this in mind, I had developed a Q4 paper, which clearly speaks about machine learning for cybersecurity. So the agenda that I'm going to take across today is going to be, I'll just take you into the abstract of what we are going to learn in this webinar, then a basic introduction of what research work I have done so far, what are all the methodologies that have been included until now, and I'll give you a detailed explanation of what each methodology is, what is the data set that has been used, why that particular data set was used, and finally a long and or a brief conclusion, in fact, of what my research has been. With no further delay, so basically when we talk about cybersecurity for machine learning, we need to understand that the research and the advances in the field of machine learning, they have produced algorithms and technologies for improving the security solutions, which is going to help us in identifying and advancements in the making advancements in making it possible for cyber criminals to use the very same knowledge and deal it in their way to ensure we find a solution decisively with the cyber threats that have been increased. Now, on the contrary, if you see the brighter side of all these advancements, it is possible for the cyber criminals to use the very same knowledge for crafting and launching bigger and more sophisticated cyber attacks. Now, this webinar is basically going to focus on certain literature survey that I've done over the days with respect to certain data learning, deep learning technologies, techniques for cybersecurity. Now, also there is a little bit of machine learning that I've also added in because when we're trying to perform a task with a given data as input, we need to ensure that it makes its performance progressively over time, right? So certain machine learning and deep learning techniques are explained how relevant they are going to perform the tasks and how progressive they can get over the time and all this with respect to cybersecurity alone. We see that there is, you know, there is a huge increase in digitalization globally, but security is a question mark. It's a concern, right? Because it's also growing at an alarming rate. So there are certain dynamics and progressed security technologies and procedures that we counter the complicated nature of cyber attacks. This becomes imperative. Now, this seminar is basically intended to sensitize certain research work which is desired to bring their work in the field of machine learning or deep learning with cybersecurity. I will also give you certain references that I've made over the days to citing their distinct works, some valuable examples that can be given to how cyber problems can often be tackled by deep learning or machine learning. And I'll also say certain defensive and offensive behaviors on cyber attacks that have been targeted at machine learning or deep learning models. I'll also tell you the applications of malicious code, behavior of network traffic, malware system call sequences, certain intrusion and detection also, I will take you through. Now, when we are coming to introduction part of it, we say there is digitalization, right? We say there is digitalization. We have reached its peak globally. Everything has become digital. Digital security also continues to be a little daunting, right? Because it is a concern at the moment. With the increasing fire in finding a place in the public domain every day, and the digital world is becoming more and more open sourced, these developments they have resulted not only in evolution in the network technologies such as the intent, but also while they are trying to provide certain greater access to cutting edge technologies, it's become more easier than before. Correspondingly, if you see the very same research findings and technologies, they are within the research, within the reach of both the security analyst and obviously, very unfortunately, the cyber criminals or the cyber crooks also. They also put in all their interest to carry this malicious or nefarious activities. But if you see the silver lining to this, all these dark clouds with undesirable consequences, research and the advancement in the field of machine learning and deep learning, they've definitely given us certain algorithms and technologies where we are also able to improve our cybersecurity solutions. This how? By trying to identify and decisively deal with the security threats. On the contrary, the brighter side of all these advancements is making it possible for these cyber criminals to use the very same knowledge in crafting and launching bigger and more sophisticated cyber attacks. Now, when we take on a daily basis, how we are going to check our normal mail, the same way we are also trying to check something called as a spam folder. Sometimes it could be the resume, or sometimes it could be the offer letter, or it could be something, you know, you've been waiting to hear from someone very important. All that goes and sometimes goes gets and stuck in the spam folder. Then how is this, so why is it called as a spam folder? Because the computer by default tries to scrutinize your emails that you're receiving. While scrutinizing it, it also tries to think that yes, certain diligent or certain normal mails also look like certain hoax mails. Then what is this spam mainly doing? So that means to say that there is a single or multiple users who have been flung, who have been given, who are getting humongous volumes of certain unsolicited messages. When we talk about unsolicited messages, that means to say certain unwanted messages. Like you say, I am so and so, I need money, I want to do business with you, you have won the lottery, you have been selected for this job profile, there is vacancy in this job profile. It's just the click of the button. The moment you open the mail or you click on certain link they're giving, at the hind, at the background, obviously, there'll be certain stuff that gets downloaded without your knowledge, and somebody is getting, the systems can get hacked, or the system is down with certain malicious code. There's a virus or a Trojan, or there is a worm, or there are Trojan horses running. So we, I mean, this has become a terrible problem for most of us. So certain reliable anti-spam filters, they basically came into picture to shut or arrest these kind of spam messages. Then the person who's sending these spam messages is referred to as a spammer. So basically his work is going to be, he's going to gather email addresses from different websites, and he will send the viruses through the spam message. Okay. This was quoted by Awad M. and Fakwawa in 1998. But over the years, there has been a great concern that is concerning the spam messages, raising a lot of apprehensions up, as they can find, they can potentially affect our lives. So a spam has been classified as a spam message, spam email, certain malicious spam. Organization have already making huge investment in machine learning technologies for improvisation of these mail spam detection. If you see in the second quarter alone, we have seen that in 2020, most of the phishers, they've been targeted to attack, especially against the small companies like the startup companies. Why are they trying to attack the smaller companies? Because they know that, you know, they cannot be lured into a honeypot by the smaller organization. Only to lure and attract the scammers that is going to imitate the email messages and the website of those companies where the products or the services, they will be their potential victims. None of the web elements will be appearing reliable as a scammer. He would have created a fake except for the login form. So now what can we conclude? So the prime aim of a spammer is to get the login username and password of the target only, right? The entire, website is fake. The login page is created the same way. That means to say the moment he gets the username and password, he will be able to enter the website. That is his primary target. So once he enters, he has got A to Z information about the entire user. Now, how can this be done? This can be achieved by luring the target, by making him to enter the login credentials of their email account, giving them the catalog which is desired by the user. So in a simple way where we just try to give in the user details, the spammer starts to start taking about details, and the phisher will obviously start either luring amount from our account or trying to put the wrong or the fake messages, trying to send unwanted things from our mail ID and so on. Then we have something called as the malicious code. Now this comes into being when the software, it intends to harm or extinguish the operations of the system by either adding, changing, or deleting just a few lines of code. There is only few lines of code that would be made change by an illicit user under normal conditions only. So over the past, if you see malicious code instigations are mainly, as I told you, viruses, worms, Trojan horse, etc. If you see on 29th June 2020, Microsoft Security Endpoint Threat Report stated that in Asia-Pacific region alone, we are higher than average encounter for malware attacks. We had about 1.6 times higher than the remaining world. So I think India stands at the seventh highest malware encounter rate. And we had the region over 5.89% in 2019. So which is like, you know, 1.1 times higher than the regional average. The record was achieved despite 35% decrease in malware encounters in 2019. So an increase in this malware code count, this is going to reflect either in loss and harm, which is growing in parallel. Then we have something called as a network intrusion and detection. This is coming in two types. One, you're going to recognize the pattern and behavior of the intruder in the network. The second one is you're going to make attempts in the systems by collecting and analyzing the main data in the network and the computer system. So these are the two focuses that we have with respect to network intrusion and detection. So now, if you see the efficiency of intrusion and detection, this can be improved if the malicious code will be identified accurately, efficiently, and at the start itself. So when we are trying this malicious code analysis and detection, this is going to continue to remain as the main problem in intrusion detection technology. Then we have certain cluster of computerized computers, right? Which are compromised. You need not work directly in one single place. Okay. This can easily be done even remotely also. So a cluster of compromised computers that are worked remotely to execute corresponding attacks or fraudulent acts, this can be referred to something as botnet. Botnet now, this is evolving constantly, and hence we have the existing detection approaches which are a little lagging. But if you see, off late, we are able to tack its detection problem, behavior and analysis of the network traffic, because that is the only solution that we have. Now, when we are talking about these kind of approaches, the only approach is we need to observe the similar pattern that botnet is going to use across the life cycle. So the main aim is going to be we're going to simplify the order to become efficiently and in identifying unidentified botnet traffic. So when a botnet is described, we have various internet computers that have been placed in an instituted connection where they're connected to each other as per the, Hellman et al's words. Now the constant evolving behavior of botnets, this has been proved that many of the traditional detection methods, they prove to be totally unsuccessful for the given essential detection results. But what is going to be the prime aim of the botnet? When you're giving new commands episodically, all we need to do is these botnets, they must connect to the bot master. Once the bot master is connected, once they are connected, obviously any commands that are going through it will go to the botnet easily. So this is a behavioral observation. This was perceived for a very long time of observation. And the objective was basically we need to understand the behavioral detection method. Then the last one is the stratostrophe. Now in the stratostrophe, we have the intrusion prevention system, IPS. So this is basically, we are going to give the society the state of art behavioral IPS. Okay, so this will basically be built on the Markov model. We have been generating highly promising results. But there is also still any time scope for continuously improving because it suffers from problems from committing to memory. But if you see on the contrary, we have something called as RNN, which is recurrent neural network. And this is shown to be efficacious when you're going to deal with it at a large state sequence because it's going to make them a feasible applicant on the task sequence behavior analysis. So let's see how this large short-term memory, LSTM, this is the word we need to remember because we're going to specifically try to recognize the distinct sequence of states, how generally they are changed over time. So for this, we are going to use an analysis of the LSTM network, which is nothing but large short-term memory. So now moving on. So this has been a brief introduction. So now we'll start with the methods. The first methodology that we'll be seeing today is the spam feature using restricted Boltzmann machine. So when we're coming to restricted Boltzmann machines, so RBM, so this is going to have two layers. You can see in the diagram itself, two layers. You have the visible layer and the hidden layer. So this is V. V stands for visible. H is the hidden layer. And we have something called W in between. If you see here, W of IJ, from W to W of IJ. So this is the weights. So this is part of the unsupervised learning. So like if you see the classic Boltzmann machines, neurons are in the same layer. They are not connected to each other. The neurons will be in the same layer, but they will not be connected in the same layer itself. But if you see the architecture of restricted Boltzmann machine that is there, if you see in the visible layer and the hidden layer H, you will be able to see there is a multiple connection that is going on in an M cross N matrix. So from H, if you see, it is coming to V1, H is coming to V2, V3, and V of M. So this is the restricted Boltzmann machine. Okay. So if you same way see, V also is connected to H, H2 and H of N. So there are multiple connections that are happening between them. Okay, so this is going to be in a M cross N matrix where weight is W. So the W models the weight between the two neurons, the visible layer neuron and the hidden layer neuron. So each of this, is called as a neuron. So if you see W of IJ, this stands for weight between the visible unit VI and the hidden layer H of N. If you see here, V of N, H of N. So this V of IJ is this. Okay. So that's the reason this is M cross N matrix. H of N, V of M. Okay. So when we further get down into this, we have seen Silva, Alexandria, Costa, Kelton, Papa, then we have Gustavo, Victor. They are all proposed an experiment where you can enhance the spam detection by understanding the features using this restricted Boltzmann machines. Okay. For this, what they did was they enhanced the harmony search, which is based out of the GEM technique in 2009. So for this, you're going to have four parameters: rate, weight decay, alpha, hidden units, N. Okay. So just to have certain comparisons, they had two experiments, experiment one and experiment two. Okay. Two experiments were done. So to ensure that they had accuracy, they made a cross validation using 10 runs. So 50% of the data set was for training, and the rest was for testing. So when we came to the data set, we have spam base, we have link spam, we have the CDCFDMC data set. So when it came to spam base data set, this was taken from the UCIML repository. Now over here, we had about 4,601 samples, out of which 39% of the samples were classified as spam messages. Each of the spam messages had about 57 attributes. So now the feature is signified over here as the occurrence of each word by dictionary set by the authors. Then we have the link spam database. So the database basically had spam and non-spam email messages. They were gathered through the linguistic mailing list. So there was about 2,893 email messages, where 2412 were non-spam and 481 were spam messages. Then the last one, if you see, the third one was CSDMC. So this was divided initially itself as training and testing. They had about 4,327 messages, in which only 2,949 messages were spam, non-spam messages, and 1,378 messages were spam messages. Now, they have used the same dictionary of words for all these three data sets. And all the samples were labeled as spam or non-spam. Even in these three data sets also, they were very clearly labeled spam, not spam. Now, the experiment which they proposed, if you see, it was stating that they had about 10 agents. They employed over 50 iterations for merging all these three methods. They also engaged for about 100 iterations. Epochs is nothing but iterations. And they had a mini batch of size of 100. This was for the RBM learning weights procedure for their contested divergences. So the harmony memory considering rate and the pitching adjusting rate, PAR, HMCR and PAR, basically it was to prevent the harmony search and prevent harmony search and improved harmony search to get stuck from local optima. So basically they've utilized new in this process step to ensure they get new solutions. So they had about two experiments and they had accomplished to gauge the robustness of the proposed approach. Now, when you come here, the first extracted the feature from the data set, this was based on the dictionary. So dictionary-based approach this was. This was called as the original. In this experiment, they had done a lot of reconstruction on the experiment one. What happened was the outcast of this was that they had learned the impact of more acumen and compact set of features by the RBM, which was optimized by the HS-based technique. So as you see in the slide, the spam-based dictionary, this was the basis for LingSpam and CSDMC, which seemed to be a bad choice because it did not give the results they expected than the spam-based data set. So this basically showed that the hidden neurons did not impact the quality training samples and the result also. Next one, when we go to the second methodology, which is classification of malware system call sequences. So the malware zoo, they are basically executable files that are the input data. They are retrieved by executing malware in a safer environment. Now the results that has been processed was to ensure that they get numerical features that are then getting forwarded as neural inputs, neural networks as an input. So this neural network, this is going to classify the malware in the respected predefined malware family. So the authors of this particular call sequence, they have used TensorFlow and Theano. So the malware samples came from three sources, VirusShare, MalRetrieve, and a few private collections as well. So this was a diverse volume of data which was much needed. They had Cuckoo Sandbox as an open source tool, which was used to execute the malware and as this provides as a controlled environment. Now, when we see malware, they get executed. All the samples were recorded, which came from the kernel API. And further to this, to help in malware classification of the malware samples, there were classification labels which were obtained through the VirusTotal. This VirusTotal, you can get this from the website from 2015. And those VirusTotal services, this is basically to leverage to get to see the malware analysis result and certain specific signatures for the sample in the malware zoo. Now, if you see, we have an antivirus signature, which they wanted to. Retrieve the labels. This was basically for the supervised learning techniques. When each of the extracted unique samples which they needed, they did a numerical labeling for it. Now we have certain antiviruses because the versions or the way they provide signature through the virus tools, they have certainly, they are tough for classifying the tests in machine learning. So to ensure, you know, you get out of this, there was an approach that was to execute the cluster of signature from various other antiviruses and get the classes from the resulted cluster. So in this way, you get what you want. So this is nothing but this, they have used the reverse engineering tactic, because the larger scale of data set, this is not at all an ideal scenario. Same way when you come to the experiment. So this is the in neural network architecture, there was a combination of convolutional and recurrent layer into one neural network, which is going to help us have the maximum possibilities. So you have a convolution layer and a recurrent layer, which was added into one neural network layer. So now what was this convolution layer doing? This was for feature extraction from one raw hot vector. Okay, so this is capturing the correlation between the neighboring inputs and certain inputs that were being provided by the feature itself. Then we had the recurrent, right? So this particular recurrent one was trying to get this done on a iteration or a recurring part. So this was not only for one convolution convolution layer, but this was recurring. So in this convolution layer, they used two filters, which is of size 3x60. So what happens was the outputs that are coming from the convolution layer, which had about 3 grams of instruction for each 3x60, the outputs were getting connected in the recurrent part. So inside the neural network, you had this convolution layer, which was 3x60 with 3 grams of instruction. So these outputs were getting connected in the recurrent part in the neural network. So each output had been filtered from the convolutional filter. This was considered as one vector. So remember, I was talking about the LTSM earlier. So this LTSM, these cells were used as a model for the resulting sequence. Now the redundant data that was there, they were initially getting removed from the sequential numerical feature vector, and how the data is fed as an input to the neural network. So there is basically a pre-processed sequence that is getting performed, and this was removed from the repeated sequence from each API calls. So there were certain API calls that were present in the data set, and they needed a unique binary vector. So one hot encoding was used, and they were using this zero feature vector. So the result of this, what happened was that you had the accuracy, precision, and recall. So the if you see this particular diagram, you will understand. When it came to experiment one, if you see, when it was a convolutional network plus the LSTM that was in place, the results were significantly very nice if you see the average result. Same way when they were trying to use the hidden Markov models and support vector machines, if you see, the results were a little varying, because if you compare deep neural networks to HMM, you can see even the accuracy precision, there is a lot of variation, especially accuracy and recall. It was in 47.5 and 47.6, but when it came to deep neural network, it was 89.4 and 89.4. Even precision, if you see, it was at 71.6 and the difference was at 85.6. But support machine vector was kind of close by, because it was again just one or two average that was getting just missed here and there. But when we saw the results of various neural network architectures like the LSTM with the convolutional network. Okay, oh, this is stuck. I'm so sorry, I don't know, your slides are stuck. Now you're all able to, so are you able to see now?
Yes, ma'am, now I can see all three.
Okay, are you able to see the slide now?
Yes, ma'am, now I can see, ma'am.
Yeah. So this was the status of it. Then if you see the hybrid malicious code detection, so over here, what was happening is that they were starting to use certain auto encoders. So this is basically you're going to have a detection model where you're going to have the auto encoder space that is going to come in. And based on that, you're going to have certain spaces which is going to get mapped into various other dimensions. So if you even talk about auto encoder, this is part of unsupervised learning basically. So in artificial neural network, you're going to basically use it for efficient data codings in the unsupervised manner. Now what this is going to do is this is going to basically represent encoding for a set of data, which is typically for dimension reduction. So you're going to train it and you're going to ignore all the noise signals. When we say signals, it means the noise. So along with the reduction side, you're going to reconstruct something where the auto encounter is going to generate from the reduced encoding or representation as close as possible to its original input. That's the reason you get the name auto encounter or encoder. When you look at the basic architecture, you again have an input layer and then you have an output layer with a hidden layer in between. Now, when you talk about auto encounters, you have something called as the feed forward. That means it's in a forward architecture. And it is a non-recurrent neural network. If you see in the previous, methodology, we had a mixture of convolution and recurrent layers. So where you had, they were interconnected. I mean, they run through the epochs and in the recurrent layer in the neural network, they get connected. But over here, this is a non-recurrent neural network. So this is basically similar to the single layer perceptrons, which is getting hidden and which is going to participate in the multiple layer perceptron, MLP. Okay. So for this, you have a target value Y for given inputs X. So the data set that was used over here is the KDD CUP 99 data. So we had about 5 experiments that were planned, encoder, which had about 5 layers. So once these 5 layers were got, what they tried to do is each layer, hello?
Hello.
So you're able to see?
Yes, ma'am, I can see.
Yeah, so there were about 5 layers. So this was user to root, which is UZR. Then you had the R2L, which is remote to local. Then you had probe. Then you have denial of services and DDoS, which is and you had the normal data. So basically over here, we used about 4,94,021 records for training, 3,11,029 for testing. Now each data set over here had 41 properties each. So this was a humongous one. Because if you see in the other data, you just had a similar, very small ones. But this seems to be really humongous. So when we see that there are evolving constantly and there is an existence of detection in the approach, obviously you will tend to add in a lot of features and try to find out how each of them were trying to prove to be effective. Okay, so finally, what happened is that you add in the input samples, then you're going to try digitalizing it and you will be normalizing it with the input data. So over here, then you add the auto encounter because that is the one that's going to reduce the dimension and it is also going to help us in the feature mapping. Then you have the eigenvector as an input which is going to again help in the dimensionality reduction. Then you have certain network parameters that you're going to initialize for the DBN classifier. Then you're going to train it using certain RBN, Boltzmann learning rules, and then save the results, because this needs to have the weights and the biases. As I said, this is a non-recurrent layer, right? So obviously weights is very important, and you add the bias B to it. And then you had certain supervised learning procedures in the layer, and then you do it for the BP network. Finally, whatever test samples are there, you're going to give it as an input for the trained classifier that we have come through this hybrid detection model for detecting the malicious code and the normal code. So then we had, this is called as the recurrent neural network for botnet detection behavior. So I said something about the LSTM earlier itself. So there was a construction that was there where you're going to have the LSM network. And over here, you're basically going to have a certain, the ideology over here is basically you're going to transform each symbol into the binary vector for encoding the behavioral connections to the LSTM inputs. So what's happening is that you're going to have certain possible symbols that can be used in the behavioral model. Over here, the binary vector size is of 50. So every element that was used in this vector, it did present a symbol. So there were two issues that were observed while they tried to build this detection model. First, the size and proportion of the historical data that was used to build this model. Second, what is the count of connection behaviors that was belonging to the botnet class? That has to be equal to the normal class. Now, having the state, it was possible the learned model could present a bias to a majority class. Secondly, it was essential to know that the optimal length of connections, states that were required to correctly detect the malicious code and proactively prevent the usage of the unwanted computational time. Now, if you see over here, you have the data set that was taken from the Seawood University campus. So this is the traffic network that was taken. So if you see anything in pink over here, that means the classification was a incorrect one. It did not detect any botnet. But if you see the bluish ones, it means to say that the botnet was getting classified. So if you see over here, you have the HTTP, customized encryption, binary downloads, you have the SMTP non-encrypted private proxies. So you can see the amount. And same way, you have the measuring from 0 to 1. If you see in this place, the botnet was detected at the maximum of 1. You have places like this where there were 125 connections that were detected at a stretch for an unknown attempt. So you can see the percentages over here. Okay. When we come about LSTM, we have something called as the undersampling and oversampling, which is supposed to be understood very clearly. Now, undersampling, you're going to balance the class randomly with certain random instances getting removed from the majority class. Oversampling, as the word says itself, you're going to balance both the classes. The randomly selected instance will be selected from the minority class, and they will be duplicated until the class can be made even. So for this, you have about k-fold cross validations, with k, which is going to be equal to probably 10, which can get trained for the on the LSTM network. For this, we had two parameters. There were about 50 iterations executed, and we had two result comparisons. One is for the ADR, and that is the attack detection rate, and one more was the false alarm rate, which is FAR. This proved to be a little neat, because when we came into the result, we saw that LSTM gave about 0.08 for ADR and 0.3 for FAR, which is like performance loss was at 15% for ADR and 1% for FAR. And when we come to the bar plot, which I showed, which is seen, the analysis seemed to be fair enough, because it was correctly classifying the connections. and incorrect was not that huge. So since you know the start of the computer revolution, cyber attacks have always tried to stay a step ahead, either to misuse different kinds of softwares that have been vulnerable to execute malicious activities. Now, with the deep learning technologies that has been reasonably well established in the industry, we can see that the attackers are now searching for alternative paths to misuse this domain. Now, strikes on deep learning systems, they are stereotypically discussed from the adversarial deep learning. We also saw that there are certain relations to providing security while using certain deep learning techniques through associated tasks such as malware detection, NIS, IPS, spam filtering, botnet detections, malicious code analysis. Now, if you see this deep learning, it has been quite useful from the security perspective. It could be for defensive and attacking viewpoints. And also there are certain probable threats that are aimed at the deep learning models itself. So that means to say deep learning is a strong tool and we are able to apply it for automating complicated defensive and offensive cyber activities. Now, throughout this, when we saw the first one, we had the Rich Boltzmann, so that we basically used the Harmony search technique. We saw the impact. It was it came out where we had the, it was similar to the original database itself. And then we had the hybrid neural networking. We saw we had the malware classification. We had good results. And then we saw detection network behavior. We saw where we had LSTM in it with the usage of undersampling and oversampling techniques. And the botnet, rather than the normal traffic, we saw there was an imbalance for a traffic in few cases. Then we saw even the botnet. In botnet, we saw that we had complete independent tests that were performed. And we had the opposite traffic only that is getting imbalanced. And we also saw how adverse or what kind of adverse was happening with the botnets. Cyber attacks, they are influencing the deep learning in the collection of cyber weapons. And we're also able to predict the experience from the highly sophisticated and big attacks, which is getting driven by artificial intelligence. So what final analysis we can say is that both cybersecurity and deep learning experts, if they can combine together and if they can focus on the recent progressions in deep learning with the adversarial deep learning, we can kind of come out and find how we can continuously strive for more advancements. Because if you see the attackers, they are also getting sophisticated with the technology, right? So even they are also trying different ways. They're also searching patterns. So if we can try to reduce that, or if we lay our hands on it and find a more secure, sophisticated model, keeping AI in mind, some artificial intelligence trying to come into picture, we can definitely adverse it, and we can make the best possible out of artificial intelligence to ensure our security is maintained at its best. Because data is everything. Data is the only thing we can work on. It has everything that we need. So losing it to certain cyber criminals is definitely a point to think about. With this, I would like to conclude my webinar, and you can reach out to me through iRaj if there is any questions, suggestions, or if you want any kind of webinar, please reach out through iRaj, and I will definitely answer your questions if there are any.
Thank you, Professor Gitanjali ma'am, for sharing your valuable time.
Thank you,
for joining this webinar. I would like to thank all our sponsors and coordinators. I would also like to thank our president. We will be happy to hear your comments and compliments or suggestions at our Facebook and Twitter page. This video will be available shortly in our YouTube channel. Kindly subscribe our official YouTube channel, iRaj Conferences and Seminars, for all past and upcoming webinars and expert lectures. Thank you all. See you in another webinar soon. Thank you, ma'am.